know, another topic that there's been a lot of conversation about lately is the importance of ice in the washing process, and is an iceless washing process better? You know, I'm curious to hear some of your thoughts on like what you would prefer, and yeah, just like what you think might be important there, basically.
Yeah, so this is a newer kind of exciting tech that people have just been playing around with for past like 2 years or so.
Yeah.
And everyone's always thought that ice was needed during this process. I mean, it's called ice water hash.
Yep. Right.
So the fact that we're like removing ice from the process, a lot of people are like, well, how are you even gonna get a yield, anything like that? The water does the work.
Yeah.
If your water is cold and your environment's cold, those trikes are extremely brittle. And if you have the right shaped trike, it's just falling off the stock.
Yeah.
You really don't need much agitation.
Like, so the shape of your ice cube is not that important, is basically what you're saying.
It actually is. So if you were to have like cubed ice, essentially, that was like sharper, you're gonna get more of a shearing effect in your wash.
Okay.
You don't wanna be using that barrel ice because stuff will get trapped inside, but it is, it's very important to pay attention to how much ice you're using, not only for the shearing effect on the plant material, but again, when we were talking about temperature earlier, you can actually get the water too cold, where it starts to develop like frost inside
like
of itself.
Like a crystallization.
It almost becomes like a slushy effect.
Yeah.
And you notice, I'll pull out the bud and it'll be encased in like a layer of ice.
Yeah.
And the trikes become completely trapped. So you're actually hurting the yield by getting it so cold, where you think you're helping something, it's actually now encased your trike and you're losing yield because of it.
Let me throw you a little bit of a curveball on this topic, because I agree with everything that you said, but the best kind of defense I've heard of ice is that when you have ice and flour, you know, in a solution of water, the ice is creating all these like little eddies. You know, just kind of areas where there's turbulence and there's water crashing around and just, you know, stuff bouncing off each other. You know, what do you think the response is to something like that? You know, if you're a huge proponent of iceless washing, basically.
So I would say that the cannabis material itself being frozen ahead of time.
Okay.
That's all you need. If your water is that cold, that material will stay pretty frozen.
And it's almost hard.
Exactly.
Okay.
So
that makes sense.
You notice if you use like a fresh RO water that's warm and you spray it over your material, it almost becomes like soggy.
Yeah.
You're trying to avoid that during the wash. If I can keep that bud kind of semi-frozen.
You want some structure to it a little bit.
Exactly.
Still. Yeah.
I don't want it completely frozen and to the point where it's brittle. Again, if it's too cold, it honestly increases the amount of shearing that you're getting just because it's so damn brittle at that point that you're getting chlorophyll in the wash. So I like to have this perfect golden point of right above 32, no ice, and I just try to keep that throughout my washes.
That makes a lot of sense. And it's always so interesting how temperature is just so important in extraction. You know, not even just with solventless, like, you know, something we see in solvent-based extraction a lot is, you know, you need incredibly cold temperatures to properly de-wax, you know, in the hydrocarbon extraction process. And it's just, you know, it's just always interesting to think how important temperature is and all those sixth grade chemistry classes coming back to us pretty much every day, it feels like.
Extremely, extremely important. And room temperature, also extremely important.
You
could have a freezing cold vessel, and as soon as you go to transfer the hash into your filtration station, it's hitting that warm air and just sticking all to the bags and stuff. You don't want that.
What, little bit off topic, but what is the coldest you've ever heard a commercial facility operating in for a solventless room? I think I've heard of guys getting down to like maybe 45
or so.
Yeah,
I was gonna say right about 40 degrees.
Yeah.
Yep, little over freezing temperature. And I mean, yeah, you're working in a freezer at that point.
Yeah, no, that's, I mean, you're in the Arctic.
Yep.
Yeah. So, you know, another question I've kind of had in my head is, you know, hydrocarbon extraction seems to yield a little bit higher than solventless, and it's kind of hard to understand exactly why that might be. So I'm curious just to hear some of your thoughts on what you think that explanation might be.
So with solventless, we can only physically remove that trike head we were talking about, that capitate head with that tiny little stalk. We're not really getting 100% of the cannabinoids found in the plant.
Yeah, there's some loss.
Exactly. With a hydrocarbon, it can essentially strip everything.
Yeah.
there's just certain strains that do not yield well for solventless that are absolutely incredible. Taste-wise, yield-wise, that doesn't mean that they shouldn't be made into hash. So I always like to say the best case scenario for a lab would to have both.
Yeah.
You wash the stuff that washes, everything else can either be smoked as flour or turned into BHO.
Yeah. No, and I think that's one of the funnest parts about being a hash maker is you have these decisions to make, and it's not just something, you know, where you can pull out a calculator and you're gonna have the right answer. Like what we were saying earlier, you have to use your senses. Like yep. you're
and sometimes the, you gotta test wash. Exactly, sometimes yeah. you can think something is gonna just yield amazing and you put it through the water and nothing comes out. So
yeah. On that topic, what's a good test wash size? Like what's your preferred kind of methodology in terms of just vessel size and amount of flour that you're working with to get a good idea on potential there?
Yeah, so you really don't need much flour at all. I'm sure you've seen the little tiny jar.
Yeah, the little mason jars.
Yep, yeah, exactly. So if you have a bunch of phenos that you're about to go wash and you really want to determine first, you know, which one's going to yield the best, we'll knock those out first. Do that simple jar test. You only need about an ounce of fresh frozen flour. I like to keep all my variables the same, so I'll put the same amount of water and ice in every single jar,
okay.
Give them the same time, shaken up, and then it's just a visual inspection process. Whichever ones yield the most, I'll start there, and then you kind of go through the list. You can use as little as an ounce. I've seen people coming out with like almost miniature yield test washers with a little bag of like 50 to 100 grams in there. So you really don't need much to just to see how it's washed.
Okay.